Sorry, I've just been given the green light over chat to go ahead and get things started. So awesome. Hi, everyone. I'm Oliver Wong. I'm on the programming committee for this year's Pop Conference. And it's just delightful that we are, you know, today is the launch day for the 2020 Pop Conference, obviously in a different format than many of us were expecting. But I'm very thankful that we have so many people in our panels and panelists, papers, et cetera. And of course, the participants, all of you here spectating, so that we can still have this in some form or other. And it's just my pleasure to be moderating this block. We have an hour set aside for this panel. It's called Persistence of Memory, Revolution, Desire, and Transgenerational Nostalgia. There's one change, or actually two changes, one of which is that Anthony Kim, who was our number three presenter, is not going to be joining us today, unfortunately, but it does free up a little bit more time for the rest of the panelists. And so each of them has roughly about 12 to 13 minutes to present. And we will start with Julianna Chang, who has a new paper title, which I will allow her to present.
Thank you, Oliver. Let me see if I can share my screen here. So So I do have a new title for my paper, A Best Part, Pop Ballads and Asian American Wistfulness. Now I'll talk a little bit about that change. And I also do have a few short video clips that I'll be playing. It's possible there might be some lag or some slowness, but hopefully you'll still get the gist from the videos. The two girls float, weightless, suspended in space and time, staring up into the sky. Adrift, they gravitate effortlessly toward each other. The music is wistful, longing, tender, though the girls have no need to long for anything else. The voice and instrumentation are gentle, the lyrics are plaintive. A love like ours is love that's hard to find. How could we let it slip away? This scene from the movie The Half of It, directed by Alice Wu, captures the utopic feeling when you're a teenager of someone finally, fully getting you. Wordless communion is bliss. The Half of It centers on Ellie Chu, an introverted, motherless Chinese-American high school student with a gift for writing. One day, after wooing her through love letters ostensibly penned by football player Paul Munsky, Ellie spends a day soaking in a hot spring with her love, the artistic Aster Flores, finally without the alias of heterosexual romance. With a name like Aster Flores, flower upon flower, how could Ellie's object of reverie not be utterly beguiling? My mom loved this song, says Ellie, of Chicago's If You Leave Me Now. She said every song, movie, story has the best part. At hearing the gentle guitar solo in the middle, Aster muses, was that it? Ellie responds, you asking or saying? Aster smiles in recognition. I was saying.
That was good.
This scene and its music stopped me in my tracks. It was a moment of utter surrender to satisfaction and fulfillment. And yet the lyrics and tone were so bittersweet, pointing backward to a lost mother and forward to the social forces conspiring against disunion toward the apparent inevitability of loss. This paper is part of a larger project on the musical soundtracks to Asian American stories and Asian American characters. For a while now, I've been intrigued by musical accompaniments such as the opening chords of the Spandau Ballet's True and the montage sequence depicting Dev's parents' immigration to the United States in the Netflix series Master of None. When I first wrote the proposal for this conference paper, I thought of this music as creating a sense of transgenerational nostalgia, a feeling of nostalgia of the child of immigrants, not for their own memories necessarily, but for those of their parents. As I worked more on this paper, however, I found that wistfulness was a more nuanced term for the complex feelings evoked by the music. I've been thinking as well about other invocations of 1970s and 80s pop ballads and Asian American texts. The poet Pragita Sharma writes about how she started hearing sentimental, apparently overwrought 70s songs, such as Dan Hill's Sometimes When We Touch, as messages from the dead. For New Yorker critic Hua Shu, Paul Young's Every Time You Go Away articulated the feelings of Taiwanese family members separated across the Pacific by new work opportunities and demands. I attended college in the 1980s, and like many Asian Americans who came of age in the late 80s, my young adult soundtrack quickly became hip hop and club dance music. I gravitated toward music that was loud and defiant, rhythmic and pulsating. But now in middle age, listening to the 70s and 80s ballads of my youth have helped to uncover a tenderness in me that was otherwise engulfed by the scar tissue of bluster and bravado I'd put on to survive a tumultuous household as a child of parents whose own early lives were shaped by World War II, Japanese occupation, in the Chinese Civil War. And of course, at this conference, I have to give a shout out to Karen Thompson's book, Why Karen Carpenter Matters, for helping me reclaim the voice of Karen Carpenter as one of my strongest sense memories growing up on Guam in the 1970s. Playing records on my dad's turntable was my most treasured activity as I grew older. The mechanical arm lifting up, moving toward a rotating disc, dropping the needle on the groove. I remember vividly the mahogany brown of Dad's album, The Carpenters, singles 1969 to 1973, and Karen Carpenter's warm, placid, yet knowing voice, enveloping me in a worldly womanliness that offered a safe haven for my mother's daily rages. The scenes featuring True and If You Leave Me Now strike me as key moments of Asian American wistfulness, though their source text could not seem more different. Master of None, with its mostly ironic tone that teeters on the verge of glibness sometimes. The half of it, witty too, but far more earnest. It was Master of None that made me think of nostalgia, but the half of it that evoked wistfulness. There is some overlap between these affects, but nostalgia tends toward a conservative containment of feeling, while wistfulness is more open to acknowledging and feeling pain evoked by the past. I find that the music creates a twinge of tenderness, that it makes us feel the character's sense of longing and hope, as well as the ache of having left or been left by family, home, and the familiar. How can we understand Asian American forms of wistfulness and tenderness? We have written in Asian American studies about racialized trauma, displacement, violence, melancholy, loss. For people that live through trauma, self-protectiveness is a natural response. And yet the walls put up by self-defensiveness can close us off, preventing feelings of true connection and belonging. This is the conundrum of survivors. How does music, in this case, the genre of pop ballads, help us to negotiate this conundrum? How can pop ballads allow us to make oneself vulnerable and open to connection when one has been and will be susceptible to harm and hurt? The opening chords of True accompany the montage of Dev's father's memories, his plane from India touching down, the birth of his baby, the happy glances exchanged between father and son in Dev's childhood. True is a love song with one of its most memorable lines, "I know this much is true." The scenes in their soundtrack evoke the mythical utopic feeling of the early parent filial bond as the truest thing one could feel in one's soul. The montage stages a story that can feel cliched in its ethno-heteropatriarchal mythologizing. And Aziz Ansari's lack of reckoning with a real world story about his pressing for non-consensual sex also frames our reception now of his series as somewhat unsavory. At the same time, I would also like to think about and think through how other real-world contexts can help us break through some of this cliche and glibness. The episode, aired in 2015, opens with the adult Dev facing the camera directly, addressing government leaders. An actor, he overplays the role of Dr. Vincent, the scientist who warns the world of a coming plague. "The sickening," he declares, punctuating his announcement with deliberate eye contact and a dramatic pause, "has begun." This satiric tone is an example of the series' potential to lapse into glibness. But nearly 180 days into COVID quarantine in the Bay Area here, this parodied virus outbreak movie has a different resonance. Dev's father and mother, Ramesh and Nisha, are not just tropes of the misunderstanding and misunderstood Asian immigrant parents. We can also understand them now as the vulnerable elderly. Dev's parents are famously played in this episode by Ansari's real-life parents. And in this slide, you also see Aziz's brother, I believe his name is Aniz, who also works on Master of None. His father, Shukat, is a natural in front of the camera, effortlessly conveying genuine emotion and charm. But I find his mother, Fatima's performance most intriguing, precisely because she is not a natural in front of the camera. Ansari has stated that his mother hates acting, and she says she only does it for him and his brother, which is such an Asian immigrant parent thing to say. At the end of the episode, Dev gives his father a guitar and Ramesh improvises a goofy song on it. "Sorry, Mr. Chose," he sings, forced to acknowledge that his wife does not like Chinese food. "We are not coming to your restaurant today." "Stop it," Nisha remonstrates. I hear her reproof as breaking through the glibness and smoothness of the series' ironic tone. While distance and idealization can evoke a more nostalgic perception of the immigration montage, Fatima's flatness of delivery of lines such as, "I sat on the couch and cried," when asked by Dev about her first days in the United States, encourages us to ask what ruptures and losses lie beyond the protective sheen of nostalgic immigrant stories. Here I return to the half of it, which is a story about how we can care for each other when that care does not appear to be reciprocated in the ways that we expect according to normative cultural scripts. The three teens, Ellie, Paul, and Aster, seemingly caught in the love triangle that we anticipate will resolve into a dyad with one party excluded, manage to still express care for each other. But as the soundtrack of Chicago's If You Leave Me Now suggests, it is also a story about how we do depart from one another. Ellie, who has lost her mother, must now make a decision about staying or going. "If you leave me now, you'll take away the biggest part of me." Or in the lyrics of the Paul Young song that Hua Shu discusses, "Every time you go away, you take a piece of me with you." But while the loss of the other is felt as a severance, the other person also leaves a part of themselves with us, maybe the best part, even if that best part leaves us longing for more. In the face of limits and constraints and loss, Asian American stories of wistfulness acknowledge grief and persistent desire for more, for utopic feelings of connection, for impossible returns and resolutions. The narratives that these pop ballads help tell acknowledge what has been taken away and that we can savor the best part of what remains, however fleeting, however much it cannot be fully apprehended. Thank you.
Thank you so much,
Julianna. Yeah. All right, next up we have Valerie So with Forgive Me for Being Wild and Yearning to Be Free, a song for Hong Kong's protests.
Okay, so I'm gonna try to do that critical karaoke thing. I'm gonna take, wait, I gotta, hold on. I know how to do this. So if the audio is mixed badly, just let me know in the chat and I'll try to fix it, but I think it'll be okay. Okay. All right, oh shit. The 2019 protests in Hong Kong consumed headlines around the world. And as with the previous mass demonstrations in Hong Kong in 2014, pop music played a significant part in these demonstrations. One song in particular, Boundless Oceans, Vast Skies, which you hopefully can hear playing softly in the background, resurfaced as a touchstone for the 2019 protests. The song is by legendary canto-pop rock band Beyond, who emerged in the 1980s with a string of hits that topped the charts in Hong Kong and across Asia. Although many of the protesters were not yet born in 1993, the year of the song's release, it still remains relevant to the youth of Hong Kong. The song from their parents' generation continues to inspire young people in the territory today. Music has served to unify the Hong Kong protesters as they fight for self-determination in the face of the increasing erosion of civil liberties in the territory. And this classic power ballad remains a beacon for the Hong Kong people more than 25 years after its release. Unlike most canto pop, which is practiced by solo singers such as Jackie Chang, Anita Moy, and Leslie Chung, Jackie Chung, not Jackie Chan. Beyond plays band music. Formed in 1983, their lineup includes the brothers Wong Ka-kung and Wong Ka-kui, who led the band and whose deep baritone vocals were the band's hallmark. Tragically, Wong Ka-kui died in 1993 from a fall from a rickety stage in Japan at the age of 31. Beyond's sound falls firmly into the late 20th century rock genre, though they sometimes add a pentatonic scale here and there to mix things up. Their popularity in Hong Kong continues the tradition of performers such as Sam Hui, the father of canto pop, who in the 1970s popularized American-style rock and roll in Hong Kong and made it his own. Hui was the first popular singer in Hong Kong to sing in Cantonese, the city's primary dialect, thus localizing the pop music of the time. Beyond carried on in Hui's footsteps, singing rock music in Cantonese. Boundless Oceans, Vast Skies is one of their most famous songs, and it was released just prior to Wong's death. It became one of the signature songs of the 2014 Umbrella Movement, where protesters occupied several main roadways in the city for months, demanding the rights to directly elect legislative representatives in the city. And you can see behind me, there's a picture of the protests. It's called the Umbrella Movement because people use these yellow umbrellas in part to block tear gas. Its anthemic lyrics celebrate a desire for freedom and the preservation of ideals in the face of adversity. So I'm just gonna read some of these lyrics. Forgive me for being wild and yearning to be free, yet fearing someday I might fall down. To give up a dream, it isn't hard for anyone. Never mind if someday there's only you and me. Undaunted and carefree, I will forever sing out my songs, walking thousands of miles. The song exemplifies the role of cantopop in the formation of Hong Kong identity. As musicologist Yu Wei Chu observes, cantopop functions as an important vehicle through which the people of Hong Kong articulate their identity in a bottom-up manner. Although the most popular song in the 2019 Hong Kong demonstrations was the city's unofficial national anthem, Glory to Hong Kong, protesters also sang Do You Hear the People Sing from Les Miserables, as well as the Christian hymn Sing Hallelujah to the Lord and Boundless Oceans, Vast Skies. During the 2019 protests, huge marches took place across the city, with the largest counting 2 million protesters, which in a city of 7 million represents nearly a third of its population. I think my math is right, but if not, it's a lot of people. Unfortunately, the government and the police in Hong Kong cracked down hard with tear gas, violence against demonstrators, and mass arrests that continue to this day. So in some ways, Boundless Oceans, Vast Skies represents a nostalgia for a gentler and less brutal time in Hong Kong history, harkening back both to the 2014 Umbrella Movement as well as to the pre-1997 handover era in Hong Kong. Although the early 90s were also a time of anxiety as residents anticipated the 1997 handover when Hong Kong officially passed from British rule to Chinese rule, that time is still seen as many by a golden era, wherein residents still felt safe and in control of their city. I'm gonna let this guitar solo go on for a bit, and then I'm gonna actually show you a clip of people singing the song in the streets. All right. Okay, let's see, shoot. Hang on, I'm sharing screen now to get to my little clip. Clip's only like a minute, so. Where is it? All right, here we go. Oh, hold on. Oh, wait, no, I forgot. I know I'm supposed to do the music thing too. Hold on, share screen. Share computer sound. Okay, got it. Okay, there you go. Okay, so as you can see, that's a shit ton of people. and all singing along to this amazing song. Oops, hold on. Okay, so the coda to this, I just spent the past few days furiously rage posting about boycotting the new Disney movie Mulan. Hong Kong demonstrators are targeting the film because its lead actors have expressed support for the Hong Kong police, even in the face of the egregious human rights violations that have escalated in the past year. The boycott has led to a closer examination of the film's production practices, which include shooting many scenes in the heart of Xinjiang province, where China is systematically oppressing the minority Muslim Uyghur people. In this case, pop culture intertwines with politics, much like the way that Beyond's song has done. This reflects the profound influence of a song, a poem, or a film on real life events and on the creation of history. Done.
Very well done.
Thanks.
All right. Thank you, Valerie. All right. Last but certainly not least, and again, for folks who are joining late, Andrew Kim, unfortunately, is not part of Connect, was not able to join the panel today. So we're going to, Anthony, we're going to the fourth paper here, which is I've Been Tired, Teenage Soundscapes of Queer Filipino Desire and Disconnection, presented by Thea, Quiray, Tagle.
Thanks. Thanks, everyone, for logging in. I'm just going to start now. Who has the luxury of being bored? As I represent this paper on boredom, music, and queerness for our current times, I want to be clear that white boredom is violence. It is genocidal. White boredom, or rather disaffection, shoots explosions that start forest fires to announce the gender of unborn children. And my window outside is apocalyptic, right? Aftermath of all these wildfires here in California. White boredom builds walls, steps on necks. White boredom calls the cops on black men birding in Central Park, because when you feel like others, black, brown, queer, indigenous others, have taken your joy and your jobs and what you believe is yours, and you have nothing else to do but seethe, you act out. White boredom, like other white affects, has the power to kill. This piece today I'm reading isn't about whiteness or white boredom. And rather, I wanted to explore the boredom of queer Filipinx youth living or trying to make a life in white suburban spaces that have literally been built to keep us out. I was and am interested in the musical soundscapes that mark our disconnection from normative structures of family, sociality, and our distance too from other Filipino Americans who hold on to failed American dreams by embracing white nationalism hard. I want to explore queer modes of connection that queer Filipinx youth have formed across the distance when we recognize others whose soundtracks match our own. In what follows, I'm going to just briefly share some of my own story and sounds that I have recognized in recent books by queer Filipinx writers, Elaine Castillo and PopCon's own Karen Tongson, just to begin to consider how music helps us to inhabit alternative life worlds that can be boring in a good way, so that we as queer Filipinx folks can begin to create places that and where we can actually survive. Let's see, hope this works. Reading about Filipino American suburban youth cultures in the Bay Area, my adult self feels downright jealous of all the fun that they had and I did it growing up. Oliver Wong's Regions of Boom and Christina Balance's Tropical Renditions both linger on the magic of house parties DJed by mobile crews made up of young Filipino American men. Groups like Sound Explosion, The Invisible Scratch Pickles, and Mobile Hype. Between the late 70s and mid 90s, Wong notes, on any given weekend in the Bay Area, there were dozens, if not hundreds, of parties jumping off, with Filipino American DJs and B-boys owning the scene. Phil-Am, R&B groups like High, and problematic DJ faves like Hubert came out of the scene, which impacted a generation of 90s kids born and raised in the California suburbs. Dominated by young brown men, both working class and middle class, let loose with latchkey kids while their immigrant parents worked day and night, this Filipino-American party scene seemed to me as a wondrous teen dream of racial alliance and solidarity to escape the boredom of suburbia, the stuff of legend and fantasy that I clearly longed for but could never touch. The soundtrack of my transient childhood, spent between Manila, New Jersey, and Connecticut, was decidedly less cool than these party scenes in the Bay, and infinitely more solitary. My social gatherings as a kid weren't wild house parties, but I sometimes had a living room full of uncles and aunties belting out Sinatra and other karaoke standards. As a closeted teen in the early 90s, I lived in an Air Force town in the so-called Redneck Riviera of Northwest Florida, where good old American rock music and the burgeoning alternative music scene filled radio airwaves. I was awash in the sounds of Nirvana, The Doors, and I hate to admit it, Sublime, Black, my soundtrack to long drives alone to nowhere, an escape from Confederate flags and the country music of my predominantly white high school. My teen years were so profoundly boring, aka traumatizing, that I retain nearly no memories of this time. There were no Filipino-American house parties, but at least over time in many other cities, I found my own people. Other queer, Filipinx, Black, Latinx kids who grew up like me, liking the Smiths, who karaoke'd to Alice in Chains' Rooster and to Rihanna. You know, other loners who you could be alone with, together. In finding such anomalies over the years, other Filipinx people, especially queer and trans Filipinx folks, who grew up loving punk and rock and even corny throwback pop, I recognize that our sonic attachments chart a different route of migration, labor, and settlement to and in the U.S. Our stories diverge from the dominant narrative forged of the San Francisco Bay Area and its straight young men, first those Manong laborers working in the fields, then its young turntablists keeping the beat going, as ground zero of Phil-Am culture in the U.S. One key component is this. Our proximity to ongoing militarization in the U.S. and Philippines, and not simply to a generic or imagined middle-class whiteness that structures queer Filipinx attachments to rock and pop music. My teenage years were spent in such close proximity to military bases that even if I wasn't an actual military brat, everyone else around me was. Militarization impacts the lives of so many Filipino diasporic peoples, orienting our music taste towards so-called white music, even when we don't narrate the story as such. For example, Karen Tongson's 2019 book, Why Karen Carpenter Matters, charts the author's personal journey between her adopted country of the United States and her birth country of the Philippines, alongside the travails of America's lead sister, Karen Carpenter. While other Filipinos on the islands were mainly consumers, that American pop and rock hits through outlets like the Far East Network, which is the branch of the Armed Forces Radio Network servicing Japan, Okinawa, the Philippines, and Guam. Tongson's family were music makers in their own right, singing cover songs of U.S. hits all over Southeast Asia and Japan, and other cities marked by imperialism and war. Raised on this diet of American pop standards, Karen finds after immigrating to SoCal as a teen, that her attachment to Karen Carpenter is seen by her new peers as corny, out of step, and out of fashion, as Filipinos have always been seen as behind, the little brown brother to Uncle Sam. Thompson writes, quote, "Even though Karen was supposed to be my gateway to a whole new world, albeit a world obsessed with yesterday's once more, she actually ended up being the anchor to my old one, to the Philippines, where corny still means something. And even if the Carpenters were perceived to be the whitest of musical acts, nothing felt more Filipino to me in those first lonely years fresh off the boat than the sound of Karen's voice," end quote. Documenting Karen's grueling, Karen Carpenter's grueling physical attempts at performing normality, Thompson finds solidarity in their both failing to conform to normative femininity. Quote, "Like my namesake, I felt lost in the eternal sunshine of Southern California, adrift in something bigger than the insecurity of prevailing messages of joy and the good life inspired in disoriented souls. Both of us were longing without exactly knowing what for," end quote. Throughout Why Karen Carpenter Matters, Karen talks and recuperates Carpenter's legacy from that of a tragic celebrity who died of anorexia nervosa, the eating disorder mapped onto bored white suburban women's bodies, transforming Carpenter into an object of ongoing desire, especially for those cover artists who have styled themselves the Karen Carpenters of the Philippines. Quote, "The Carpenters, like the Filipinos who love them then and now, became originals by making the most beautiful copies, sometimes of themselves, to transform what we have, and sometimes the little that we've been given, into something far more remarkable. In claiming Karen Carpenter as belonging to us, to Filipinos who have the power to reanimate her as our echo, Karen Thompson transforms her own fandom and the Filipino people's enduring fandom of the Carpenters into something abject, from something abject, or plain corny, into something more, an icon for queer possibilities, a beacon of hope on the horizon, even when we all know that time will never come. If a love of hip-hop and R&B in California Philan youth indexes their social and spatial proximity to Black and Latinx communities in the U.S., our love of rock and pop music marks other proximities, the violence and ongoing U.S. war in the Philippines. Returning to the Bay Area of the 80s and 90s, documented well by Wong and Balance, Elaine Castillo's 2018 novel, America's Not the Heart, is a feminist and queer bildungsroman that chronicles a young woman's journey to rebuild her life after the horrors of displacement, trauma, and war. Hero, the novel's protagonist, is a 30-something recent immigrant to the South Bay suburbs of Milpitas, a spot where all the Filipino-American women have grown bored of the social scenes that they're compelled to be part of. In one hilarious aside, one woman whines, "Do I need to see another dude spinning Planet Rock with his dick?" as her excuse to not go to yet another house party. Hero's quite different from these other Bay Area-raised Panay women, and her love of rock, pop, new wave, and other, quote, music about white people having feelings is commented on several times by other characters in the novel as markers of her estrangement. We learn over time why and how Hero has come to the U.S. and why she's so attached to her rock cassettes, some of her only possessions that she's been able to bring with her from the Philippines. Without wanting to give too much away of the plot, Hero's participation in the guerrilla war against Ferdinand Marcos's U.S.-backed dictatorship in the Philippines has nearly cost her her life. And the Bay Area, with all its suburban boredom, becomes respite and refuge impossible anywhere else. By the end of the book, Hero's life seems completely boring, mundane. She's got a hot girlfriend, she cares for her eczema-ridden niece, she works at a Filipino restaurant in the community for, you know, more than just money. Reviewers of the book have complained that nothing much happens except for long sequences around food and sex. I guess they don't like scenes of queer sex. But the book's finality is its strength. In this void of suburban ennui, Hero germinates the seeds of revival life. Her seeming post-political orientation, soundtrack to 90s new wave and rock, challenges readers to recognize the radical potential of cultivating a domestic life as a politicized act, a world-making act so often denied to trans and queer women of color. By way of conclusion, I want to reiterate that our love for these suburban white boy or white bread music, our loyalty to the Carpenters or New Order, Fugazi or the Smiths, are queer attachments that are not a desire to be nearer to whiteness. These musics were and are the soundtracks for multiple forms of displacement brought about by endless war and militarization in the US and Philippines. Sounds that have signaled disconnection and loss, but which somehow still allow us to find each other across the distance. Thank you.
Very well done. Thank you.
Well, thanks to everyone here. Such great papers and certainly, I think, some interconnections. Why don't we open, we still have about, what, another 22 minutes here. So why don't we open things up for discussion? And I usually like to have the, if the panelists have questions for one another, to have that start off. Not to put y'all on the spot, though.
Oh.
Okay. If not, then I'll open it up to the larger participant body. Are any questions out there? And if you don't mind using the raise your hand tool in Zoom, that would make things a lot easier for us.
Well, I had a question for Julianna about this distinction that you make between nostalgia and wistfulness. And it sounds like you're thinking through nostalgia in more of like the negative closed off sense. Can you say a little bit more about how you see that play out in Master of None?
Well, sorry, I just want to make sure I unmuted myself. So that scene, that montage sequence that I played, you know, speaking of corniness, to me, there was something that was so corny about the music, the, you know, the glances exchanged between father and son. It was, I mean, there was a part of me, like every time I see that, there's a part of me that's sort of like laughing and cringing, but there's also part of me that tears up too, you know, and thinking about what parents and children do go through together. And in some ways, I think some, you know, connections can be very hard won. So I was trying to break through, I think, some of what happens with nostalgia, which is, you know, what they call the kind of like, you know, looking at it through a rosy hue, kind of the narrative being tied up in a bow and like, oh yeah, that was a really nice time. I wish I could go back there. I know I can't, you know, like there's something that's so kind of, contained about nostalgia to me. Whereas for me, wistfulness is more like really acknowledging, I think, acknowledging loss and trauma. So I was thinking a lot about like, you know, our three papers, you know, I've been thinking about wistfulness. And then with Valerie, you know, thinking kind of about the more anthemic elements of music, but nevertheless, you know, I think music that people think of anthems, I think, as kind of being like really declarative, but to me they can be really tender too, you know, these moments of real connection. And then thinking about boredom and how, you know, you were talking about how that novel Nothing Much Happens, I was thinking also about the half of it. I think it's a very quiet movie, and I think for some people they would feel like it was very boring. So I'm also interested in, you know, what is it that's happening, you know, in these so-called boring moments of music too.
I'm going to just jump in and say something about tenderness and vulnerability in anthemic songs, because I think one of the things that draws me to a lot of Asian pop music and films is the willingness to embrace vulnerability in more masculinist forms like rock music, like action films. And so that's what's really beautiful about it, is the ability to acknowledge doubt and insecurity, and not only feeling like you have to be strong and vulnerable and powerful. Yeah, or finding power in a different way, I guess.
Mm.
Yeah, so.
Yeah, again, I think related to what I think both of you are talking about, there's, you know, there is that kind of feeling. I mean, there's this feeling of disconnection and loneliness and alienation that music can articulate. And there's kind of this paradox where it allows us to make these connections with each other, kind of across these feelings of alienation.
Yeah, and I like how both of you. For me, that's what I was trying to get at the end, right? Like, all of us are lonely together. And I'm really feeling that super deeply now, sitting in forever quarantine with the sky burning outside, right? But how do these, you know, pre-Zoom technologies of you know, shared cassette tapes and mixtapes get transmitted, and how do we hear them to recognize other lonely queer folks?
Yeah, I mean, I think what Thea is talking about and Julianna too is that reappropriation of what seemed to be a certain kind of pop music and really kind of, you know, as you say, queering it, right? Just turning it around and making it part of our own cultural interpretation. And I think Karen does that really well in her book as well. Sorry, Karen, shout out to Karen. one thing I have to point out that it's really funny about the protest in Hong Kong is one of the songs that they did sing was this Christian hymn. And that's partially because in Hong Kong, many mass demonstrations were banned by the police, but religious gatherings were not. So people claimed that the protests were religious gatherings by singing this song, even though they were clearly protesting against the government. So, you know, really kind of like subverting a lot of the music and using it in a different way is really what I think a lot of us are talking about here.
Yeah, I've been struggling with my, I work in Asian American studies, and I have been wanting to do more pop music studies, and I've really been struggling with, like, well, you know, how is this Asian American? Because so much of the music is quote unquote, you know, white music or black music or whatever it may be. But there is a way that music, that we use that music to articulate our, you know, our stories also.
Absolutely. And I'm going to give a shout out to Doug Ishii, who's on this call and who's the resident popcorn person talking about Asian American, you know, middle brown music and rock music as someone else who's thinking through these great questions.
I believe Andrew Hamlin has a question.
Hello. Yes. A question for Professor Chang, if I may. I realize this is a bit of a personal question, but did you find that you had any favorite Carpenter songs from that record or from other records? And then how did they tie into what you were talking about?
Wow.
I hope that's not too broad.
No. It's you know, it's one of those, it's so hard. There's so many that have so many different kinds of resonance. So what comes to my mind, we've only just begun, of course, Rainy Days and Mondays, Top of the World, Yesterday Once More. I have this other piece of writing where I'm thinking about the song, you know, I'm on the top, you know, Top of the World, looking down on creation. And you know, I was living on this little, you know, speaking of militarization, I was living on this little island in the Pacific, Guam. And there was something that was just so intriguing to me about, like, wow, what would it be like to, you know, to be high up and to have this kind of, you know, broad view. So there's that. Yesterday Once More, you know, I think those of us that grew up in the 70s remember that there was that kind of like weird 50s nostalgia. So there was, you know, Grease also. I think for me, that was this kind of maybe transgenerational nostalgia too, like kind of imagining my parents' generation through that song. I think those are the ones that come to mind, but really all of them just have so much resonance for me because of the way that Carpenter, I think, inflected the music, which again, you know, at the time it just felt so adult to me, you know, and so womanly. And then as I became a teenager, you know, then like that's when I was like, oh yeah, that's so corny, you know, it seems so normative. But now I'm realizing there was so much inflection, you know, in the vocalizations.
Karen raises posted this question for the group in the chat, which is, quote, I'd love to hear everyone riff a bit more on the middle brow and its relationship to a kind of post-colonial ethos. I'm also thinking about the Les Mis songs at the HK protests recently, but also obviously the Carpenters and now the dad rock of Sublime, unquote. So whoever wants to take on Karen's question here.
Well, I can just say a little bit of what I was thinking about if this was, you know, for an actual chapter instead of, right, a short presentation is in this moment in the Philippines in particular, the entire country is under lockdown and it has been The first version of this paper that I presented was in 2017 after I'd just come back from the Philippines when it was under the first stage of martial law in Luzon, outside of Manila. And I actually went down to Davao, where this new president's from, because my cousins had been telling me how amazing it was there and martial law isn't so bad. It'll be cool. Everyone's, you know, totally living normally. And the example they were showing me was by taking me to a karaoke bar, right? That amazing space of like American rock music and all of these things that you can do in the US and hey, it's safe now. And so for me, thinking through the middle brow and thinking through the banality of violence is actually in these spaces where we can consume and enjoy and perform our belonging, not just to the Philippines and what's happening there, but also to this imagined ideal of a free US, right? Continually over and over again in these deep spaces of incarceration. And I know I'm rambling a little bit, but I'm really trying to think through what is it about the continuing Filipino attachment in the Philippines, actually, right? To imagining ourselves through the United States and through these like rock anthems. not because, you know, we want to be anything like white men, right? But because it still holds something, again, in the midst of a ton of suppression.
I guess for me, I'm thinking somewhat about my own life stages. That for me, becoming a young adult was about kind of rejecting the middle brow, and I think part of this is like that feeling of non-belonging, that well, I don't belong anyway to the mainstream, so I'm going to claim these alternative forms of music, and reject the mainstream kind of as middle brow, what I was seeing as the mainstream as middle brow. And so now, again, you know, now that I'm kind of thinking, I'm really rethinking, you know, belonging and how, because for so long I haven't felt it, but now I'm, you know, I'm really trying to forge these different kinds of belonging. And so now, you know, now I feel like the middle brow is something that some of us were really judgmental about, and I'm trying to not, you know, not have that judgment and really just be open to what are the feelings that are evoked, that so many people feel through the music.
I'm trying to think about Les Mis in Hong Kong. I'm going to say it possibly is because in Hong Kong and some of the other Asian countries that I know about, irony is not the primary form of expression, right? And so it's not, there's no shame in liking something so ironic as middle brow music or Sublime or Air Supply or whatever it might be. You know, I think that's to me refreshing. I feel like irony is distancing, and irony is a really privileged position to be able to take. So yeah, so that's how I feel about Les Mis in Hong Kong.
Maybe one last bit on Sublime, because I am remembering singing it in karaoke with other queer kids of color, right? Is thinking through that post-colonial condition and the shared kind of disaffection is something I'm thinking about in terms of the US, right? Like there is something really particular about realizing that the other kids of color that you're singing with actually knows all the lyrics too, right? And then there was something shared in your complete alienation from, right, the spaces that you grew up and, you know, where you were the loner, the lone weird kid, right? The lone kid of color in that group of other, right, folks listening to this crap music and trying to fit in by humming the words to Santeria and hoping, right, that they would like you, right? Actually being able to see that in a karaoke space. And I don't know if I've sung with Raquel, but I'm really thinking of Raquel in a lot of this too, right? Recognizing that there were other people as adults that had the same kind of weird dislocation is a post-colonial condition. It's a queer brown condition, and it's one that I'm always searching for.
This is Oliver again, and if I can apply a sort of moderator's privilege to ask this question, especially given the particular brain trust that we have on the panel here, but one of my curiosities has always been, at least at a generational level, for those of us who grew up on some level in the 1980s, especially those of us who are Asian American and growing up in the suburbs in particular, is that synth pop figures very heavily into both the soundtrack of our youth, and I think this will be at least a familiar joke to some of you here, you know, that New Order's Bizarre Love Triangle is the unofficial Asian American anthem. And the question here is why? What is it about synth pop that resonated, that you think resonated with, again, generationally Asian American youth in a particular like space and place and time, that as opposed to some other genre that you know, other genres circulating in the 1980s?
I want to say, and I don't mean this in any snarky way, that in some ways it's the lipstick and eyeliner. Seriously, like that sort of like, you know, deviant aesthetic somehow related to being, you know, outsiders. And I could be totally wrong on this, but I feel like, at least for me, that was like part of it is just like, yeah, you know, fuck patriarchy.
I will say this as kid of the 80s who was too young to actually listen to Joy Division and then New Order when they were, you know, in their prime, but very much grew up with it and still primarily sings it. It is like Valerie saying, the boys were just prettier, which is great for a queer kid closeted to be attracted to a boy who looked prettier than I did. And also, again, non-conforming voice. It's easier to sing their songs. There's a flat affect and a kind of dead tone that is incredibly easy to pass as a decent singing job when you're in a karaoke space with other people. And also it is that form of connection where everyone will know, right? The poppiest of the hits, like Thompson Twins at least, and definitely Bizarre Love Triangle. So you still are passing in a variety of ways while singing something, as a woman anyway, that's less standard music. That's just my own very personal association.
If I can really quickly follow up with those two comments, do you think there would be a connection there, therefore, to the sort of younger generations, the appeal of K-pop to them?
I was just going to say, absolutely. Yeah. Totally. Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah. And I really love that about it, you know, that, you know, it's just all about, that.
Right. Well, can I say something real quick related to that, or just like, you know, observing the dichotomy that at least I faced having immigrated to the United States in the 80s and having immigrated to the Inland Empire in the 80s, so a Southern California edge city suburb, is that you know, you had the British, particularly British synth pop, right? British new wave, like, created itself as a true alternative to the kind of like cock rock 80s, you know, fist pumping, feathered hair, like all of the Hesher stuff that people were into. And that would, to me, that was, you know, that was a very American thing. That was a very American expression. And there was some way that I could still express my foreignness or alienation from the experience of Americanness by connecting onto this other more legible foreignness, which was British, which was new wave, which was, you know, accented, but an accent that everybody thought was cool, right? So I think that's sort of, and also frankly, the androgyny of new wave was something that I think that for Asian Americans who are read in a kind of spectrum of androgyny and sometimes hyperfeminized, regardless of one's like sex, right? That that there's a way in which that it made that gender ambiguity into something that felt cool or tenable, and not within that kind of really the hard and fast, or what felt like the hard and fast kind of rock genres of masculinity and femininity at the time.
Although ironically, I do have to point out that hair bands were infamous for wearing quite a lot of eyeliner and lipstick in the 80s, so.
See, that's the later 80s.
Oh, okay.
89.
Granted, yes.
Yeah, I mean, a lot of this really resonates with me. I think, you know, I was thinking, I mean, there's something, you know, something about like Bizarre Love Triangle to me, that was very much about going to the club, very much about dancing, very much about Asian nights at clubs, you know, city lights or whatever. Kind of, there's
city
something
lights.
I think there's something that felt very transcendent about that experience, like the music, but also the dancing and the dancing with other Asian Americans in the space that you don't otherwise have, you know, and it's away from your parents. But I was, you know, I really think that these comments about gender are right on too, that you know, there is, I mean, that kind of hyper-masculinity of certain kinds of American rock music, I think, you know, I think we were uncomfortable with or did not want to claim. And there was this other kind of, you know, other kind of performing and partying that I think just was more resonant.
There's definitely an anthology waiting to happen between, you know, around this topic. I'm a little, well, actually I should cease to be surprised at what academia doesn't focus on, but nonetheless, this is definitely an area that I think would.
Let's do it. Yeah.
Or a documentary.
Oh yeah, that too. Dynamic. But those cost a lot to make, so.
You know, in an efficient manner. So maybe this can be your next project. So we have about 2 minutes left here. Are there any other last minute burning questions, comments that people want to throw into the mix here? All right. Well, in that case, I want to thank everyone on the panel for such a fantastic series of papers. We're going to be in the midst of a 30-minute break here, so we will resume with the next session, which is on international relations, youth desire, and politics beyond the U.S. We'll begin at 1:30 PST. So apologies to anyone who's not in my time zone, but again, just come back in half an hour. And thank you all for, again, participating in this first day of the Pop Conference 2020.